everybody. Thanks for joining. My name is Matthias Leubel. I work at Lutze. I'm a software engineer there, mostly working on Prometheus and monitoring stuff. But I also am a big fan of like good CI/CD tools, and that's what I'm going to talk you through today and what kind of development is in progress right now that we think is going to be beneficial in the future. So first of all, the talk title is about kubectl. But before talking about kubectl, I want to ask everybody if you guys know drone. Anyone who has used drone? All right, most like, do people use Jenkins or like Travis CI, some hosted things, GitLab CI, probably? Yeah, there are a bunch of hands. Awesome. So kubectl is based on drone. So that's why I'm going to walk you through a bit about drone before getting like into the details on what kubectl like we think should be. So drone obviously is a continuous delivery pipeline. It automates everything you need to do in your CI/CD pipeline. It's open source. It's written in Go, and it also uses Docker. So each step in the container is a new Docker container, which could like contain Go or Node.js or Java or whatever. So anything that is possible to be included in a container is basically able to be a step or be able to be run in a drone pipeline. Drone supports these kinds of version control systems or like hosters basically. So I mean everything on the slide is Git, but you can like use the public ones, but also use Git or Gogs if you want to host it privately, or GitLab. You have a declarative configuration. So there's a YAML configuration, and that needs to be put into the root of your repository. So you put something like what is on the slides into your repository, and then commit it. Docker drone will ask GitHub or whatever you're using to get the configuration and then start acting what's specified in the configuration. So there are also a bunch of plugins. These are basically just Docker containers again, and they have some binaries or bash scripts in there that have predefined logic. And yeah, you can just use those. You don't need to like install them previously. As they are Docker containers, drone will go out to the registry, pull in those plugins or Docker containers, and we'll just start to run those Docker containers. So there's no real, like, other than like writing a bunch of lines into your configuration, there's no real need to set that up. So what kind of languages does it support? Everything that runs in a container, basically. So whatever is possible to run in a container, you can like run it inside a drone pipeline. And so how do you install it today? Right now, you just go out there, go to the drone docs. You grab the configuration file, add in your secrets. So for example, for GitHub, you need to have like a client and a secret tokens. And yeah, then you just like pull the images or let Docker Compose pull the images. And it's starting already. And then in the end, you just activate the repositories in drone. It will create a GitHub webhook at GitHub, for example, and it will then trigger the build. So it's super simple to set up, and that's also what I like about drone. And it uses SQLite by default, but it also has possibilities to run with MySQL and Postgres. Right now, like I said previously, Docker is the default one for drone, but you can also use the the official Helm chart that you can see on the slides, and you can also use these to deploy drone to your Kubernetes clusters. But it still uses the Docker socket, so even though you're running on Kubernetes, you are still like relying on the Docker socket, and in the end, whoever has access to the Docker socket is still root on the cluster, so that's kind of bad. So first of all, I want to show you a quick demo for the people that don't know about drone. So I have a simple configuration written down, and it will just go build, go lint, and go test at the same time. So it executes these steps concurrently, and then once that's done, it will actually go ahead and run the main function. So let's do that. I already have like the pipeline set up. Drone is running on my machine right now, as this is a development version, so I'm kind of like running it on my machine right now, but obviously it would run on your servers. And down here we can see that I am watching Docker PS, so I can see all the Docker containers that are starting and stopping. So let's go ahead and simply restart this pipeline. And as we can see, it clones the repository, and now these three build steps are running concurrently inside the Go images. And we can also stream the log output from here. It's not really a responsive design, if you can tell. So it's just, let's wait for that one. And once the linting step is done, it then will execute the run step. So it's kind of nice if you need to do things concurrently. Let's see what run says. Run says nothing. Let's try again. Still. Okay, so it says, hey, KubeCon. So that's kind of outdated, and we're going to update this Go main in a bunch of seconds. But first, let's go to the slides again. So what's next? It still uses Docker, which, I mean, is great. You can like spin up a virtual machine, start up the Docker Compose file, and then you have like your dedicated machine just for continuous delivery. But you know, it still uses the Docker socket. So I'm kind of a Kubernetes person these days. So as everybody, maybe you can do something better there. So before that, right now I want to talk about multi-machine pipelines. Multi-machine pipelines are a way to, in the future, specify multiple pipelines, obviously. And these will fan out to multiple machines in your clusters. And once they are done, they will fan in and do a step, for example, like a notification to Slack or whatever. And yeah, so it, for those people who know, it will replace the Matrix builds and Drone. So what does it look like? So right now you have like one single pipeline, and in the future you can still have like the exact pipeline. So if you're upgrading to the newest versions in the future, you don't really need to do anything except like upgrade to the newest version, and that's it. So you might have like a backend pipeline that is building your Go binaries or testing them and so on. But next to that, you can also in the same YAML file with these YAML separator create multiple documents in one YAML file and specify another pipeline there. And if you don't specify anything, they will run concurrently. And what that allows us to do is to go to one machine with one pipeline and to the other machine with another pipeline. And in the end, yet another third pipeline can depend on the previous two pipelines. So in this case, once the backend is built and the frontend is built, we are going to execute another pipeline which is running on maybe completely yet another different machine. And this will create a Slack notification for you if, and will tell you if the build succeeded or failed. So this is kind of like, if you think about, these pipelines could potentially get very, very large. And like we discussed some crazy ideas like generating a subset of JavaScript, like, or generating a pipeline from a subset of JavaScript, basically, to allow you to put in hooks. So if this happens in the pipeline, do this and that. And this kind of, I mean, it's Turing complete, so it could like bite you in various ways. And we think in the future, something like JSONet is probably going to solve a lot of these problems. So for the people who don't know, JSONet is a generating config data. So it's like a templating engine for YAML or JSON specifically. and we think that you can use that to generate really really large YAML pipelines. So for example, if you need to, I don't know, like do the same pipeline for multiple Go versions, you could have like an array of the Go versions and then iterate over those versions and create the same YAML output, except the Go versions are different in those next objects in YAML. So there's a small example on the slides. If you have any questions about that in the future, you can just come and ask me. So this is kind of like teasing it a bit. It's not yet that production ready. But what I really want to talk about is the Kubernetes runtime. So instead of running those builds on Docker and on Docker sockets and be restricted to one machine, basically, we think that a runtime that is executing the exact same pipelines on Kubernetes and not on Docker, something that should be the way forward. So I've created a Kubernetes runtime for Drone, and it needs a Kubernetes 1.10, but as it's completely bleeding edge right now, I think a lot of you folks are going to be on Kubernetes 1.10 once you can actually start using the Kubernetes runtime, so shouldn't be that big of a deal. It implements, as I said, the same interface as the Docker runtime, so it's a drop-in replacement. It takes a kubeconfig, or if you're running on a Kubernetes cluster itself, so instead of deploying the Drone server to a Docker host, you can just deploy it as a basically deployment on Kubernetes. It will use the in-cluster credentials, so you don't really need to configure anything. It just will take everything it needs. And in the end, it will start talking to the Kubernetes API server and then start, instead of scheduling Docker containers, it will start scheduling services, pods, and also persistent volumes to share the same volume across different steps that might be running concurrently. To enable that, you can simply put in some environment variables, and that's everything you need. You can specify right now one namespace that you want the Kubernetes runtime to work in. You could also have like multiple Drone deployments in your cluster and specify a namespace for each differently. So right now, what we do is simply getting the list of all nodes in the cluster and then pick a random one. So this is like super basic. But in the future, I can see things like using node affinity to schedule on certain nodes that you have attained on and then don't use for anything production ready, but only for CI/CD, but you still can use the same cluster. Also something that is not yet that well tested is building Docker containers on Kubernetes. Obviously you want to do that, and it still needs privileges. So if you want to build Docker containers, you still might need to go to the Docker socket even though you're running on Kubernetes again. So there are projects like Jesse Frizzell's image or Builder by Google or GCP and different kinds of projects. So there's a strong movement there in to have something that can build Docker images or OCI compatible images without a Docker socket in the future. And also right now, Kubernetes secrets can't be referenced from the pipeline, so you still need to put them into Drone itself to be able to get those secrets in the pipeline. And I can see something like specifying a Docker secret, and then the runtime will automatically talk to the API server, get the secret it needs, and then move on. So you have like everything contained in the Kubernetes cluster. Yeah, and the same for config maps. So there's a lot to improve there. But nevertheless, we have a basic version up and running, and it's going to be iterated upon in the next month. So I want to show you what that actually looks like. So instead of watching the Docker socket, I'm going to watch my Kubernetes cluster. And then everything I need to do is go in here and say that I want to use the Drone runtime now. So it's just like a matter of switching this environment variable, then restarting this drone instance, and yeah, let's go to the editor and say Moin container days, because we are in Hamburg, and let's just commit this one. I'm not sure if that was the correct thing to do. I just should have used the terminal. Yeah, but that sounds good. So yeah, instead of talking to the Docker socket now, the drone server can talk to my API server, and as you can see, it already created the first pod, the clone step, so it cloned that onto a local persistent volume that is running in the cluster, and now it's scheduled, like drone is doing all the scheduling still, and yeah, it created three pods, like completely normal pods, and those are running the same steps as the Docker runtime did earlier. So we can wait a bit for that to go through everything and finish what we wanted to do. For some reason, this linting step is always slow. Alright, so the lint step was successful as well, and now we are running the last step in the pipeline, and it will now say Moin container days. And once we are done, so the last step completed now too, we will completely destroy all the objects again and yeah, clean up the namespace again. So that's kind of neat, and the logs are still saved in the database of drone. So you don't need to worry about that. Drone still takes care of all of that. So yeah, this was the Kubernetes runtime, and I really hope that it enables a lot of you guys to run CI/CD pipelines natively on Kubernetes in the future. So yeah, this is like the most important thing that we did in the past month, or like this year. And now I want to come back to KubeCI. So what KubeCI is. So first of all, as I said, we created the drone runtime, and I'm working on a daily basis together with Brett, who's based in San Francisco, to make sure that the Kubernetes runtime progresses and that we can have this in the next weeks up and running also for ourselves, but like to share it with everyone else too. We still have a lot of more ideas to improve the Kubernetes runtime and to improve CI/CD systems in general. And right now, what KubeCI itself is a plugin suite for Kubernetes-based or like Kubernetes-tailored plugins. So as you can see, the plugin requests the kubeconfig that we want to talk to the cluster we want to talk to, and then apply like these three files, YAML files. So this could be like your secrets or your services or I don't know, whatever YAML files you have. And then we'll iterate over those and apply all of these to your cluster. And it does some very, very basic templating. So something like the commit or the branch that you're working on, you can fill in those variables into the template and then deploy that against your cluster. If it's a bit more complex, then you should probably use something like Helm. So we have a Helm plugin as well. And it will still, again, decode the secrets with base64 decoding. It can also set the tiller namespace you want to talk to. It iterates over an array of charts, so it will apply the same arguments that you specify, for example, the tiller namespace to every chart and then deploy against the cluster you are specifying. And in the future, that's why it's not completely bold, we want to also have the Helm version specified in the configuration for the pipeline, so you can say like, I want to use Helm version XYZ, and it will grab the version of Helm if it's not in the container itself already. And this one is really exciting. So this is what I was talking earlier about. It's about getting rid of the Docker container, Docker socket to build Docker containers. And for now, I used Jesse Frizzell's image tool for that. So it's a way of basically doing Docker build and Docker push and Docker login, things like that without the Docker socket. So you can completely turn off the Docker engine on your local machine, or if you're running on Kubernetes like this, you can still create Docker or OCI compatible containers without actually talking to Docker. And this is really exciting for Kubernetes, I think, if you need to build Docker containers on Kubernetes. And I went ahead and copied the Docker plugin. So it's a drop-in replacement for the Docker plugin. So everything you need to do is go to your pipeline and then switch out the Docker plugin's Docker image for the kubectl image plugin. And because it's the same code, basically, and talking to image instead of Docker, you can just move on with your day and don't use Docker in this case anymore. But it's still a work in progress. There are a lot of patches that need to be merged into, for example, Kubernetes itself to make that really run unprivileged. So it still needs to be privileged. So yeah, these are like the three plugins that we need for ourselves, or that we want to have for ourselves. And now is the time to like think about what plugins you might need, and what's really important to you, what kind of CI/CD solutions you need. So if you have any use cases for plugins, basically tell us. Come talk to me. I'm at the Lutze booth for the rest of the day, so you can just come there and have a chat about whatever your CI/CD pipelines are in need for. I also want to mention that Thomas and Patrick are doing a talk on scaling drone with the Docker engine or runtime. So that's going to be up next on the boat outside. And also tomorrow there's a talk about GitLab CI. So that's kind of going in the same direction. I want to thank Brett of Drone for like creating Drone in the first place, and also helping with the Kubernetes engine, Chris for supporting with the kubectl plugins, Stefan for brainstorming at FOSDEM, and also Jason for the initial hacking sessions. And thank you. So thanks for listening. I think like 10 minutes. All right. So if you have like a lot of questions, I'm happy to answer a lot of them. Yep. I can just repeat the question. Yeah, so the image tool that I'm currently using, I can already like on my machine build Docker images without running Docker at all. So that's super nice. I'm just not 100% sure how well it works on different clusters that are running Kubernetes. So it might be a bit tricky, and that's something because the Kubernetes runtime is basically done since like, or not done, but working since a few days. We still need to figure out what edge cases there are, so that's why it's still like a lot of work to do.
Experience with multi-arc binary builds and image?
It's a microphone. Oh, good, great. Have you some experience to build multi-arc images with this image too?
Docker Drone itself because yet another plugin to create multi-arch images, and you certainly can. I mean, with for example Go, you can cross-compile for certain architectures, and yeah, if you have a lot more questions about multi-arch, then you can just go to Thomas and ask him, because he's the creator of all the drone plugins
nice.
For multi-arch.
Thank you.
Yeah, so he's probably better to answer those.
You want answer more? I have a lot of questions.
Any more questions?
Thanks.
All right. If you don't have any questions, then we can just close it. And yeah, find me at the booth if you have any more questions in person. Yeah, thanks for listening. Enjoy the conference.